invite you to come on in, and as we begin worshiping this morning, grab your cup of coffee or whatever you got and come on in. I want to lift up the name of God. God has led each of you here this morning to this time of worship, to this time of saying, Jesus, you're the center of it all. We want to honor you. We want to bless your name. We want to serve you. And so, I don't know if you know this, but we serve a Father that truly loves us, that is a good, good Father that truly loves us. And, you know, sometimes we can get wrapped up in the guilt and in the sin and the things that can entangle us, and we think we're unlovable. But God is here this morning, and God loves you, and God is good. And I think that that's a good reminder for us that, God, you're good. And so sometimes when we just verbalize that, it helps it get in our being. And so even if you're not there, just proclaim, God, you're good, and I'm loved by you. And just kind of receive some of that this morning as we enter in this time of worship. I've heard thousand stories of what
you tell. Fast your pleasing. I too want to welcome you to worship this morning, and especially the many guests that we have this morning who are here with the persons who are becoming new members. And it is an exciting day for us anytime that we welcome new members into the life of our congregation. The two songs that we just sang talk about God's presence no matter what we're facing in life. No matter what is going on in my life, blessed be the name of the Lord. No matter what is going on in life, we know that we have a good, good Father that is walking with us. As we come to this time of prayer, and we know that there are persons within our congregation who are really carrying heavy burdens at this time, things that are going on in your life. And so, if you're here this morning and you would like prayer, I just invite you to stand at this time and people gather around you. And they'll remember you throughout the week. One of the cultures that we have at Clinton Frame is just continuing to develop a culture of prayer. And so I invite you to stand at this time if you have a special need this week. And just gather around them. Please join with me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are good. And that you desire what is best for us in our lives. We thank you that you are the source of life. This morning we thank you and we praise you for the beautiful rain and for how it replenishes the earth. We thank you for the time of season and the new life that is going to spring up around us. And in the same way, we thank you for your Spirit that cleans our lives and transforms our lives and gives us new life and true life in you. We thank you this morning more than anything else for Jesus Christ, and that's the reason we're here, is just to praise and to honor and to worship. But we also thank you because we know that you care so intimately about us. We thank you for walking with Leon and Pete and Larry and Jim and Nancy this week in their surgeries and in their recoveries. Father, I just pray for each person who stood this morning. You know exactly what is on their hearts. And I just pray that this week they will just be overwhelmed with a sense of your presence, with a sense of your peace in their life. May they just experience an outpouring of your Spirit of life and strength this week. God, we thank you for our missionaries around the world today, for Dennis and Connie, Jordan and Kate, John and Casey and Darren, Jason and Amanda, Allie and Kyle, Bruce and Nancy. God, may you bless each one of them where they are today. And may their lives just radiate you. And we just pray this morning here at Clinton Frame for us as a congregation that we will be filled more and more with just a deep passion to share you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I just have two announcements this morning. And first of all, many of us were here Friday for the concert, and it was just an amazing time of worship. But I just want to offer just a special thanks to the many volunteers, to each one of you who volunteered, some of you all day on Friday, many of you Friday evening. As a congregation, we came together and we provided a place just for an amazing time of worship. And one of the real blessings for those of us who are here around the day was just to meet the band members and the sincere and genuine Christian faith that they had. And that just came through in their music as they shared with us that evening. So thank you. It's one of the ways that we offered this building to the community. And this Saturday, Project Promise will be here to give the Easter Passion Play. And it is an amazing experience if you've never come to that. They have a show at 3 and another one at 6. And the building will be pretty much full. But I just invite you to come and to be a part of that. It's just a really special time as we engage with Project Promise. Also, I just want to remind you of the congregational meeting next Sunday evening, and just would encourage you, if you're able to attend that. At this time, I invite those who are becoming new members and their mentors to come up. Again, it's just a special time when we invite new people into the life of our congregation. This week there are 6 persons, and next week we'll have 6 again. And so it's always a special time to invite new people in. And so, Pat, if you would begin the introductions.
Okay, I want to introduce you to Shelby Morrissey. Her mentor is Viola Miller, and she couldn't be here this morning. Shelby was born in Iowa and moved here when she was 16. Being raised in a Christian home was a foundation for her faith. She graduated from Bethany Christian High School, and I've known her for nearly 50 years because her sister Sharon and I are friends. She's here with her husband, Roy Axline, and their other sister, Artis, and her husband, Cal. She has 2 sons, Roger, who's here and lives in Goshen, and another son, Randy, who lives in Elkhart. She has 6 grandchildren and 5 and a half great-grandchildren. Her husband, John, passed away in 2000, suffering from Parkinson's disease, and it was after that that she moved to Goshen and lives in College Manor. At 32, she went to school and became a dental hygienist, and she works part-time in South Whitley. For a number of years, she was a professional seamstress, and that remains a hobby along with reading and walking. Her faith has been really strengthened since attending Clinton Frame. She appreciated attending the membership classes where she got to know more people and also learned a lot about our congregation. We're glad to have her as part of the Share and Care class and a part of our congregation.
I'd like to introduce to you Brittany Knox Steiner. She comes all the way from Fisher, Illinois, but yet she and Nate, her husband, have been here for about 4 years. They're active in their DOC class and have just really appreciated the friendships they've built there. They have a beautiful 1.5-year-old daughter named Aubrey that's sitting over here with grandparents. And I believe Nate and Brittany met at Heston a few years ago. Now they reside in Goshen, and she's a hairdresser. You can find her at Shooby Doo's if you care to have your hair done. So we're really happy to have you here.
And it's my pleasure to introduce to you formerly Nathan Steiner. Nathan and Brittany have been attending here for a while and are now making this commitment to join us, and we're just so thrilled for that and to be here with them. Nathan was born in Goshen and grew up in East Goshen Mennonite Church. He was baptized in 2001 and went to Heston College, where he met Brittany. And they've been married now for 6 years. I think I met you almost your first week here, and that was about 4 years ago. And one of the things that drew Nathan and Brittany to Clinton Frame was hearing from, I think, a client of Brittany's that person had attended Clinton Frame, or just visited, actually, perhaps even for a funeral. And they just said that in that one interaction here, that person told Brittany, you should try there. The people there were so friendly. And so they were interested in coming to trying a different church for their own, coming from East Goshen, and exploring one, and came here one time and never went anywhere else. They've just enjoyed the people here, the challenging worship and the challenging sermons. And the worship, you might recognize Nathan from joining in the worship band up here. He plays guitar. I have never heard him make a single wrong note. And I just realized that his electric guitar is always unplugged, which is why. But he does a great job. It's an honor to have you guys here.
It's my pleasure to introduce Lois Kaufman Bontrager. She was the fifth child of Merle and Edna Whitehead and raised on a farm southeast of Goshen. She was baptized at Rock Run Church of the Brethren and accepted Christ as Lord of her life when she was 12 years old, and has a deep appreciation of the faith that has grown over the years. Lois was a member of North Goshen Mennonite Church since 1954, and now is enjoying the fellowship at Clinton Frame Church and ready to move her church letter to this congregation. She met Harold Bontrager, and they were married May the 2nd, 2015, and she's now living in Springbrook with him. Lois has three children, a son that lives in Arizona, son that lives in Ohio, and a daughter that lives local. She has two stepsons, and they live in Middlebury and Goshen as well. She appreciates the leadership here and is glad to be a part of this church whose teachings are consistent with what she believes. She thanks the congregation for accepting her so graciously.
I have the pleasure of introducing Elsie Gingrich. She's the wife of Irvin Gingrich. She grew up in Arthur, Illinois, and she was baptized there as a 12-year-old. At Arthur Mennonite Church. She was born and raised there in Arthur, Illinois area, and Irv, that's where she met Irv. And they got married, and they moved to Indiana. I think, Irv, you were in 1W service at that time. She's a retired RN, and she had worked at Fountain View in Elkhart. They have three children, a son in Florida, a daughter in Oregon, a son in Elkhart. They have three grandchildren and one great-grandchild, and they've done missions for service for at least five times down to Haiti for Water for Life. Her hobbies are reading books, listening to music. She likes to put puzzles together and word games, and she likes to do Bible studies. That's where I really got to know you, kind of, in Bible study, and she is continuing to grow in her faith. I can see that. They've been coming here for 2 years, and I'm glad to get to know her and know her better.
I'm happy to introduce to you Irvin Gingrich. Like she said, they've been here for 2 years, raised in Arthur, Illinois. He grew up on a farm in an Amish family. He moved to Indianapolis and served his 1W service in 61 to 63. Then moved to this area. In his 30s, he gave his life to Christ, feeling for the first time that he knew he was born again and experienced the presence of the Holy Spirit.
There you go.
Went to Belmont Mennonite for 23 years. They owned a family bicycle shop, South Main Street of Elkhart, I believe, for a while. And then he did excavating and trucking. So he's got to be a good driver, because trucking with those big mobile homes down the highway is quite a challenge, I'm sure. He has a passion for the unsaved and started handing out Bibles in these streets of Elkhart. He's been involved with the Gideons for 23 years. He's on the chaplaincy board of the Elkhart County Jail. And he's involved with the relief work in Haiti, and he understands servanthood. He handed out Bibles also down there. He's been involved with Revive Indiana. Thank you, Irv. You're a good man. You understand servanthood. Glad to have you with us.
It's wonderful to have each one of you a part of us and the many ways that you've already been engaged in the life of this congregation. And I know that you will be in the future, and so thank you. I have three questions I'd like to ask this morning for you to respond to. Do you believe in Jesus Christ as the Son of God who died upon the cross for the forgiveness of our sins, that he rose from the dead, and it is through him that we have eternal life? Do you recommit yourself to living a life of discipleship, as together as a community we grow in our love for God and our love for others? Do you covenant to submit yourself to being a part of Christ's body, the church, here at Clinton Frame Mennonite Church? Will you commit to giving and receiving counsel as together we strive to be faithful servants of Jesus Christ our Lord? Thank you. In the congregation, I'd ask each one of you just to join with me in making this covenant with them. Join with me. As we now receive you into the fellowship of the church, we make this covenant with you to bear each other's burdens, to assist in times of need, to share our gifts and possessions, to forgive as Christ has forgiven us, to support each other in joy and sorrow, and in all things work to the good. As we unite with each other, may we make Christ's presence known in our community and around the world. It's a wonderful covenant for us just to speak and to remind ourselves of what it means to be a part of the community of faith here at Clinton Frame. Let's pray. Father, this morning I thank you for each one of these new persons who are covenanting with us here. We thank you for the amazing privilege it is to be a part of your body, the church. And we just recognize this morning that Jesus Christ, you are our head. But in a very special way this morning, I pray for each one of these new members. I just pray that they will find life and vitality here at Clinton Frame. May you bless them. May you strengthen them by your Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And you may be seated. After the service, the new members will be in the hall so that you can greet them as you go to the fellowship meal. And I invite the ushers to come forward. There's one thing that I've noticed. When I was in here before, earlier, the clock was giving us an extra hour. And I thought, well, we have no trouble with time this morning. I noticed that they've changed the clock since then. So maybe they're sending us a message, Joel. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the privilege of just bringing to you our tithes and our offerings. We thank you. We thank you for the way that you bless our lives, for the resources that you've provided each one of us, the resources you've provided to this congregation. We pray that this offering, the money that we give today, will be used in a way that brings life and vitality to this congregation, and just shines the good news of Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
This morning, Terry thanked many of you for what you offered this weekend. You know, we had this concert here, and there was about 700 people who came, and there was about 60 volunteers. And I, it's an offering. What you brought was an offering. And so I think one of the most memorable moments of the night, I shared this in Sunday school this morning, was I was fluttering around, and one of the most memorable moments was when I came out of the office, and I saw this flurry of yellow t-shirts and all the volunteers willing to do whatever it took to make the night a success. You know, whether we knew what we actually were getting into or not, we learned a lot along the way, and just thank you for your willingness to serve as a church. This is a place that is willing to get do whatever it takes, and I say this is my church, and I'm excited. I pray that you also feel that way, that we're behind each other. As we take new members in here, we're with you. We want to walk together in life, whatever it takes. So just thank you. As the offering plates get past you and the friendship registers are by, just feel free to stand as you're ready. Thank you. present here.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is
God is mine.
more deeply today. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name.
Your kingdom come.
Your will be done.
On earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread.
And forgive us our debts.
As we have forgiven our debtors.
Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one.
For thine is the kingdom, the power,
and the glory forever.
Amen.
Today we continue on in our Lenten series through the Lord's Prayer. And as you've heard here, had the pleasure of getting youth together, both within our community and outside of our church community, to pray that prayer together, and to, as we did that video. And something that's been, I think, powerful for me is to hear all the different people within our community pray this one prayer, whether you're 90 years old or 9 years old, the power that exists within it. It's been something that's really been refreshing to me in this season, and I pray that that's been the case for you as well. So within this prayer, we have many just insightful things that Jesus is teaching his disciples how to pray. His disciples ask, Lord, teach us to pray. And he gives them what is maybe one of the most beautiful images of communication with God that we can have. It is simple and yet profound. And this morning we're going to dive in specifically to a line that when it was assigned to me to preach, I thought to myself, of course, that would be the one that I would get. Today we're going to reflect on the words of Jesus when praying to the Father, Lord, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Lord, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. So we have to talk about two things today. Two things that are powerful, meaningful, and that are just downright serious. And that first thing we got to talk about is we have to talk about what temptation looks like. A biblical model for temptation, what it means for us, what God is doing in the midst of temptation, what that even looks like for us here in present day as compared to what may have been experienced 2,000 years ago. So one thing that we kind of run into a problem early on in this text, I've always found the words, when Jesus is praying, Lord, lead us not into temptation, it's a little problematic because I was under the impression that God doesn't tempt us, that God is not the author of temptation, that's not something God would do. And so why do we have Jesus here in this prayer asking and praying, Lord, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one? Well, we've got a little bit of work to do on this idea of temptation. Most oftentimes in the New Testament, when we're talking about temptation, it's not so much as an idea of being enticed into sin, though that can be part of it. When we talk about temptation in the New Testament, we're most often talking about a trial that is to be endured. A challenge that is put before us by either God himself or sort of outside circumstances that are forming us and making us into either a child of the kingdom or a child of the enemy, one or the other. And so we see as we read James, and this is helpful for us as we kind of are talking about temptation. James writes that when tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me, for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed. Then after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death. Usually there's an internal desire within us, and so we come up against this challenge, and when this challenge is presented to us, our own inner weaknesses, our own tendencies towards certain behaviors kind of come to the surface. Honestly, when talking about temptation in the New Testament, the line that is most oftenly used is, do not fall into temptation. There's this idea of that we are tempted and we come up to this edge, but because of our own weaknesses, the own pressures on us, our natural inclination towards sin, we fall into sin. And so here Jesus in his prayer, Lord, lead us not into temptation. Most scholars agree it's a call for us to endure the trial that may be before us, that we may come out on the other side more like God. So lead us not into temptation, Lord. Don't lead us into it. Bring us through it. Because I think every single person in this room who has a pulse right now will be tempted by something. And the question is whether or not when we are tempted toward a behavior, toward a particular thought, toward a particular way we experience our relationships with other people, when we are tempted at those things, we become aware of that. We have this moment of, I've got two options here, the way of the kingdom or the way of the enemy. I can fall into this temptation, or I can be brought through it by the power of the Spirit, by God's presence. And there's some very specific ways we can be brought through temptation I want to talk about this morning. But the question is, and I think, and this is the part that, this is why this, for me, this sermon this morning is a challenging one, because when we're talking about temptation in the 21st century, when we're talking about temptation, what temptation looks like right now, broadly speaking, we could say it looks very much the same way it did 2,000 years ago when Jesus prayed this prayer. Specifically speaking, it looks very different. So we have a mixed audience here, and we have a young audience here this morning, and so I'm going to be careful with how I go about this. But I think for all the adults and people old enough to know what I'm talking about here, we are talking about things that are found on the internet that are a major temptation for a good portion of our society. Easily accessible, easily hidden from others. It's the P word. Do we all know the P word? Shake your heads, yes, we know the P word. I don't want to say this word in front of five-year-olds this morning. Okay, so, okay. Now, I'm going to give you some quick statistics on this. I'm not going to focus on this the whole time, but I just want to name this thing. We need to name it. I would be off as a pastor if I just did not call this thing out that is readily accessible in our society. So, the most recent research last year, a major study conducted, says that between 56 and 60% of all men are at some point in that year engaging in that P word. 56 to 60% of all men. Surprisingly, this might strike you as a surprising thing, a growing number, somewhere between 16 to 20% of women, this number is rising for women, regularly engaging in explicit material like that. Every single divorce in the U.S., the statistic says, of all divorces, 56% of them are the result of that thing. 56%. Where one partner has, as the study labeled it, an obsessive inclination toward that sort of explicit material. On average, a young man's first exposure to this material will happen between the ages of 10 and 12. This is not just a teenage college thing. This is our children we are talking about here. Statistically speaking, 50% of you men that are sitting in this room right now have encountered this material one way or the other. I'd like to be able to say, not in our church, not in our community. I'd like to say, not amongst we, you know, religious professionals, but the number for pastors isn't any better. And so this is a secret, quiet thing that is going on behind closed doors. This temptation in our society, one of the most major temptations that are lying before us, a challenge and a test that's before us, readily available, that we are falling prey to daily. It's ruining our marriages. It's ruining our vocations. It's ruining our relationships. It's ruining how we understand the image-bearingness of creation, where people become not human beings, but they become possessions. They become commodities. They are bought and purchased, not deeply loved and cared for. So this is what is in front of us right now. And statistically, I know that at least some of you sitting in this room right now are in that struggle. Lord, lead us not into temptation. Bring us through the challenge that is before us by these circumstances, these tests. Bring us through it and deliver us from the evil one. It is clear to me that this one particular sin, this one particular depravity and darkness that we're talking about this morning, that the enemy is on the move. The industry that facilitates this sort of content makes over, in the U.S. alone, $3 billion a year. And that number just keeps on going up. It's striking. So, I could give you list after list. I mean, the thing is, because it's on the internet, everything is trackable, it's measurable, the statistics are at times just so heavy. And you can look at them and say, we're making no headway in this. The situation is out of control, it's getting worse. We're not improving the divorce rate, we're not improving. But I believe that as a community of people that have been redeemed, that have been healed, that offer healing, I believe the church is in the best place and is so centrally located in a place in our culture right now. We have the best ability to speak to this matter and to speak to it with love and to speak to it with grace and mercy, to be a safe place where people can share their brokenness. Because ultimately, when we're dealing with the enemy is all about secrets. The enemy is all about darkness. The enemy is all about keeping things hidden. And so we're offered an opportunity to, instead of being a people of secrecy, we're offered an opportunity of people who are able to break the power of the secret. So this morning, I can think of no one better to look to when it comes to overcoming the challenges and the oppositions that come our way. I say we look to Jesus for our answer. If you'll turn with me, if you want, it'll be up here on our screen as well, to Luke 4, chapter 4, beginning in verse 1. We read, Jesus was full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan, and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil, or tested. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them was hungry. Then the devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread. Jesus answered, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone. The devil led him up to a high place and showed him, in an instant, all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, I will give you all their authority and splendor, for it has been given to me, and I can give it to anyone I want. Devil clearly claiming here, and Jesus does not argue with the fact, the authorities of this world, the governments of this world, are in my hand, and I have the ability to give them. I mean, if you're Jesus right now, and you're looking to start a new Jesus movement, governmental power seems, man, that'd be a great way to go. I have the Roman Empire behind me on this one. That'd be a real great way to go. Not the route Jesus takes. If you worship me, it will all be yours. Jesus answered, it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. The devil led him to Jerusalem and had him stand at the highest point of the temple. If you are the Son of God, he said, throw yourself down from here. For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. Jesus answered, it is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test. When the devil had finished all his tempting, he left him until an opportune time. Do we see what Jesus does here when he's tempted? Do you see his, I mean, this is Jesus. This is the Son of God, the second person in the Trinity, and the enemy comes to him. In my mind, Jesus does like Jesus karate move and we just end it right there. Done. He has the power of heaven behind him. There's all different sorts of ways he could respond to the enemy here. But how does he respond? It is written, it is written, it is written. Jesus has all sorts of resources available to him, and I find it fascinating and incredibly helpful that when tempted, when tried, Jesus goes to the Word of God. And I should say, I'm used to preaching on the west side of South Bend, so amens are allowed in here. They are encouraged. So we'll try it one more time. Jesus goes to the Word of God. Amen. Amen. Thank you. It is written. It is written. The power of God's word to sustain us in challenge and trial, unlike anything else we can go to. I mean, today we've got chicken soup for the soul times 50, every positive motivational book, feel good about yourself, precious moments, this, that, or the other. And people flock to this stuff. It's on the bestseller rack in any bookstore you go to. And here's what those books promise, that you yourself have an inner light. And if you just pull yourself up by your bootstraps hard enough, that you too will be able to overcome whatever trial it is that you're going through. Now, certainly Jesus, when tempted in the desert, by the way, in the desert, the key theme here, Israel. I mean, the desert themes in the Bible, I could go on and on about this. This is like a really, it's a big deal for me. But in the Bible, Old Testament, Israel, when they are delivered out of captivity, when they are delivered, where are they delivered to? The desert, not the promised land. I mean, that would make the book of Exodus a pamphlet. Hey, we got out of slavery and off to the luscious fields and the flowing rivers and the beautiful forests of the north. No, the desert. Now, I personally, maybe some of you have been to this desert area in Israel if you've taken a trip. 120 degrees in the shade. You can feel the moisture just getting sucked out of your body like it's being beamed up to heaven. I mean, those are challenging times. They're challenging places. What is the purpose of the desert? The purpose of the desert is to strip you of all your man-made resources. It is to take away everything that you hold in your hands and to totally and completely rely upon God, his power, his salvation, his deliverance, I mean, the whole idea of manna, right, coming from heaven day by day. What happens when Israel tries to collect for themselves and build up whatever? It rots. They're left with empty hands. We in our culture, in our individualistic, self-made culture, love the idea that if we just try harder, it'll get better. For it is written, it is written, it is written. The words of God are sufficient. I love what the psalmist writes to us, Psalm 119. I have hidden your word in my heart that I may not sin against you. What's our answer to the challenge of sin? Hiding God's word deep in our heart, making it part of our very being. We are promised in our world today all different kinds of solutions, but no solution is as good as the sustaining word of God our Father, who speaks life to us in the midst of darkness. Friends, next time maybe you come up against a challenge, a temptation. I mean, in temptations, we talked about a big one. I had to name it. We have to talk about it and call it what it is. We have to break the power of the secret. But there's every kind of temptation out there. Whether you've got a Pinterest or a Facebook temptation, whether that's sort of becoming your small g god in life, whether you've got a temptation when you are at odds with someone to speak ill of them behind their back. We never do that at church, do we? I mean, those are temptations. Those are things. It becomes clear you have an opportunity, a challenge in front of you to live out the word of God or to live out the lies of the enemy, to go to dark places. You've got a challenge to rely on what God says in his sustaining word or to go in on your own. This is the promise, by the way. When Jesus is tempted, I think both all of us could agree, a lot's on the line here. If Jesus fails this challenge, the cross doesn't mean anything. Because now you have a sinful Messiah dying on a cross for the sins of the world, and that doesn't cover us. Now you and I are, as Paul says, above all people to be most pitied. But instead, when challenged by the enemy, Jesus comes right back and says, don't you for a second think that you can get me to stray from the Father. Don't for a second think that you can get me to throw the word of God out and act on my own. Don't for a second think that while I've got nothing and I am hungry and I am tired and I am weak, don't for a second think that you've got the last word in this. For it is written, for it is written. This morning, I want us to consider the places in our lives where maybe there's some darkness clinging on. The places in our lives where we've got some secrets. Some things that we need to share. For me personally, the one way that I have found to fight the enemy off is I have someone in my life. I have a spiritual director in my life that whenever I feel the enemy coming after me, or whenever I myself have delved into sin, I get on the phone right away and I have a safe place where I can just say, here's what it is. I name the thing, I call it. Because that's how I have to go to battle with the enemy. That's how I have to take things very, very seriously. Because the moment I say, I'll get around to it, or it's really not that bad, or this thing in my heart, I can take care of it, the enemy just goes, you're absolutely right. Keep it to yourself. You got this, Joel. D- Destroy the power of the secret. Maybe you need to have someone in your life. Maybe there's an accountability person that's a safe place for you to go to with whatever it is that you're struggling with this morning. Maybe you need to spend some time praying with someone who you're at odds with right now. Is your baby being tempted to speak ill of them or to have bad thoughts toward them? I don't know what it is for you this morning. Maybe you need to get rid of the computer for a while. Whatever it is, don't play with sin. Don't dabble in temptation thinking you can overcome it on your own. Don't be tempted that way. Do not fall into temptation, but be delivered from the evil one. He's out to get you. He's out to destroy you. He is out for your very soul. This is serious business. And we need to be about the business of fighting back with the things that God has given us, his spirit, his word, his community. Beautiful things like grace and forgiveness. So this morning, as I'm going to invite worship team up, I want to provide just a few minutes for us to go before the Lord. I want us to get very serious and very real with what's in our hearts this morning. I want us to break the power of the secret. My prayer is that we break the power of the secret, whatever it is this morning, whatever it is. Lord God, we know that you can lead us through deserts in life. We know that you have that power and that ability. Lord Jesus, in these just next few minutes, may you bring to mind the places of our challenge and our temptation, the trial that we are in right now. And we can either move toward the kingdom, or we can move toward the enemy. Lord God, would you, right now in this place, would your spirit come? Would you convict us of our sin? Lord Jesus, just in these few moments, may we just have a moment with you. May we just come before you empty-handed in desperate need. Lord God, convict us. Redeem us.
Prayer team's in place, and either now or after the service, we'd love to pray with you for anything. Just want to sing, Jesus paid it all. This is where our power comes from. And I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in Oh,
Father. What good news it is that you've made a way for us, that in the midst of our brokenness, you have made us whole. We thank you for your forgiveness. We thank you for your shed blood on the cross. We thank you that that grave is empty. Lord God, for my brothers and sisters here who this morning, wherever they are, Lord God, I just pray a special blessing on them. Would you just fill them with your Spirit? Would you instill in them this desire to have a long obedience in the same direction, moving forward with you, in step with your Spirit? And that obedience might be difficult, Lord, we know. But may we tear away the secrets, may we tear away the darkness, may you just do that work in us. May we be children of light. It's in your good name. Amen.